he was going to make it to the moon first. So for him, it was really the perfect representative color tone. And he used it quite often, much to my chagrin as a curator, because the paint that Andy was using was industrial grade, gray, silver, lead paint. So that means that as a conservation, from a conservation perspective, it's a complete nightmare to take care of, because that paint chips and it cracks and it falls off all the time, simply because it was never made to be put onto a canvas. At any rate, and ironically, the Elvis paintings are perhaps some of the most valuable Warhols ever made. So if you happen to own one of those, make sure you get it conserved regularly so that it doesn't completely fall apart. This is obviously another very famous Warhol image, Marilyn Monroe. This is a late version from 1967, and it's actually a print. When Andy really got into the idea more and more of making money, and after he became one of the great living artists of America, very quickly, Andy actually had his first mid-career retrospective in 1965 at the Philadelphia Institute of Contemporary Arts. That's only 4 years after he came out with his canvas suit campaigns. Almost unheard of that you have a mid-career retrospective and you've only been making paintings for 4 years. But that's how much in demand he was. The opening for that show was so huge that there was literally no space to move in the gallery space, and the staff had to take the paintings off of the walls because people were bumping up against them. That's how loud it was. Everybody wanted a part of Andy Warhol. Well, Andy realized that, and he was thinking, okay, I can do maybe 10 or 20 Marilyn paintings, but if I keep churning out the same painting, the value is going to go down. People aren't going to want to spend as much money on them because it basically turns into a poster. And then he realized that by doing works on paper in print editions, he could make a lot more money. So around 1965, 66, he started to do a lot of edition works. This image you see here is from the Marilyn edition from 1967. There were several different colors in the series, and each one had a run of 250. And he realized that you might not be able to sell a print for more than 20 or 30% the price of the original painting, but that once those fractions of prices started to add up and be multiplied by 250, that was a lot of money. So again, he was thinking of this idea, how do I produce, how do I use this assembly line mentality to make money? And luckily, just as much as he liked to make money, and he liked to spend money as well. He was an inveterate shopper. He was out constantly. He would go to antique stores every day to see what had come in that morning. He went to jewelry stores. He was infamous for wearing diamond necklaces under his almost ever-present black turtleneck. In the 80s, he got very into sort of spiritual healing in crystals. Remember when crystals was a big thing in the 80s? He would wear crystals under his clothes, in his pockets. And he was a pack rat of epic proportion. Many of you probably know at the museum we have Andy's time capsules. We have 610 cardboard boxes filled with stuff. Andy just kept literally everything. I think we probably have enough silverware to serve at least 120 people, simply the silverware that Andy stole from British Airways or Air France from the Concorde when he would travel to Europe. He nicked everything, salt and pepper shakers, little bottles of whiskey, and we could open a bar and be stocked for a good couple of months just on the little trial-sized liquor bottles that we have. He would pocket everything, and anything that came across his desk, he would keep as well. So he was just a constant consumer. His staff, Andy was also a little bit thrifty in life. I mean cheap, really cheap, but he liked to save money. So instead of hiring movers when he moved from factory two to factory three, he decided that he would just have the staff run down to the stationery store down the street and buy some blank cardboard boxes to put all the paperwork and things. And it was really messy. So they bought these cardboard boxes, and they just started piling paperwork and objects, whatever was around the factory, into these boxes. And while they were doing that, Vincent Fremont and Bridget Berlin, who both worked for Andy, said, and they still to this day fight about who said it first, said, oh, we can tell Andy these are time capsules, and we'll steal them, and then we can open them in 30 years, and he'll be really excited by what's inside. So they said that to Andy, and again, fabulous. I love it. And from that day on, a cardboard box sat right next to Andy's desk, and anything that came across, again, an assembly line, comes in, Andy looks at it, deals with it, throws it in the box. And that's how it went on throughout the rest of Andy's life. And as soon as one box would be full, they would seal it, tape it, write the month, in the year, on the top, and off to storage, it would go. And we have 610 of those. To date, we've only opened 200 of them. We found everything from, well, half-eaten sandwiches, birthday cakes, $17,000 in cash, which I still to this day have no idea how that money got in that box, because Andy counted every last cent that he had. So I can't believe that somehow mistakenly got into that box. It had to be a mistake. But paintings, drawings, photographs, movies, all sorts of amazing things, and very mundane things, newspaper articles, letters from both completely unknown people, and had a lot of stalkers as well. We just found one box that had over 30 letters from one guy who said, I want to meet you, Andy Warhol, over and over and over. Really scary. So he was just constantly keeping everything. We just received a grant from the Andy Warhol Foundation, which manages the state in New York City, to do a 6-year cataloging project for those time capsules. So we're opening 1 to 2 now every week, documenting every single item inside of those time capsules, recording it, and digitizing it. So by the end of the project, in another 4.5 years, we'll hopefully have every single item recorded, written down, and listed, inventoried. And we're doing a website, just for real fun. So when the project is done, you can go on to our website, click on whatever time capsule you want, and then go through every item inside. Did anyone see the article a couple of 2 or 3 months ago about the Jackie Kennedy poster that we found? It was a full-size poster of Jackie completely naked, sunbathing in Greece when she was married to Aristotle of Amasis. And Ari thought that she was getting a little bit too big for her britches, being too glamorous and too jet-setty. So he hired a paparazzi to come and hide in the bushes and take nude photos of her while she was sunbathing, which were then leaked to Hustler magazine, which was, of course, one of the